In this medical minute, we're going to talk about heat-related illness. Don't forget to subscribe, comment, and like the video. Thank you.
Don't be sorry. Just tell them the beatings will continue until the morale improves. I saw that on Vegas. It was like a pirate thing. It says, beatings will continue until the morale improves. So that was hilarious. So I want to talk about something very pertinent to the summer, especially here in Georgia and how hot we are. Does anybody can tell me the difference between heat exhaustion and a heat stroke? Anybody? Yes, temperature is one of the criteria. Anything else? Heat exhaustion versus a heat stroke. Perspiration. So people who are sweaty are probably more in the heat exhaustion phase and not in the heat stroke. By the time they get to heat stroke, they're usually pretty dry. Usually, by that point, because they already passed that stage and they can't. Symptoms and stuff like that. So temperature is the main thing. 40 degrees temperature puts it into the heat stroke category, but you can have a 40 degree temperature not be on heat stroke. What really defines a stroke is the altered mentation. They're having to start to have encephalopathic findings because they become altered. All the other symptoms, the nausea, the vomiting, the cramps, the muscle pain, abdominal pains, those are the heat exhaustion phase. So when the heat exhaustion phase, that's when you can really intervene and make it better. From a paramedic standpoint, from a pre-hospital, or even in the ER, is preventing progression to the heat stroke phase. And you do that by cooling. You cool them as fast as you can. Anybody knows what the best way to cool a patient is?
Fluids.
Ice in the armpits. I like that because we'll talk about that. Ice in the groin. All right, so I've known this for a while, and then when I was doing the medical minute for today, I found out that there's some newer stuff out there. So my answer was always evaporation. You put warm water on them and you put high blowing fans to them. Evaporation is the fastest way to cool a patient, but you do that in the heat exhaustion phase. If they're actually in the heat stroke phase, the best modality is not ice pack in the groin and the woo-woo. It's actually immersion in cold water. You actually put sheets and create a little pool on the stretcher and dump them in cold water. Obviously not very tolerated by awake patients and make them shiver, it hurts, it's very uncomfortable. It's difficult to put IVs through water, especially if they're icy. It vasoconstricts the surface, but apparently that's the best way. But you don't do it forever. I mean, their temperature is 40, 41. You only drop them to 39 and then you take them out of that, because then you get hypothermia, which is just as worse in terms of hemodynamic stability. You wanna drop them 39 and then assume other cooling measures, meaning hydration, fluids, that's one way to do it. You can put NGs and drop cold water in. You can put a Foley catheter and drop cold water in and then bring it out. If you are worried about heat exhaustion and you're getting to the heat stroke, you have to put things to monitor temperature continuously, either an NG with a probe or a Foley with a temperature probe. Doing axillary temperatures during that doesn't work. They can get vasoconstricted on the surface, so they might actually be cooler outside than they are inside. And especially if the paramedics already put ice packs and stuff, then they might be too cold on the periphery for that. Mainstream is they get really dehydrated, so you gotta give tons of fluids. They get really hyponatremic, especially if they knew they were getting dry. They might have been drinking a lot of plain water and made themselves hyponatremic. So we discussed the difference between heat exhaustion and heat stroke. So when you tell these people, oh, I had heat stroke and they gave me fluids and sent me home. Obviously not. Heat strokes go to an ICU, okay? And they get admitted for 48 hours. So they had a heat-related illness. Maybe they had heat exhaustion. Maybe they had an electrolyte, renal insufficiency. They were sick, but they didn't have a heat stroke. They have to have the altermentation to be a heat stroke. And we're obviously gonna see a lot of that as weather gets hotter and humid. Usually, especially elderly, because they are on medications that affect thermoregulation. Here's a question. Does Tylenol help with heat stroke? You give Tylenol for the fever of 40 degrees. No, because the Tylenol, what it's gonna do is reset the hypothalamus to tell them don't cause a fever. But the body's not causing the fever. The fever is coming because they're hot. not because it's they're making fever when it's from an infection, it's because the body's telling the body to get warm, to heat up, to kill bacteria and viruses and stuff like that. But since this is not related to hypothalamus, it doesn't work. You don't have to worry about talent, just cool them up. And that's it.